off. My name is Antje Danielson. I'm the Director of Education at the MIT Energy Initiative. I would like to start by thanking our sponsor, IHS, who is making this seminar series possible. And hopefully we will all join the very first one of the series this semester. Furthermore, I would like to tell you a little bit about the MIT Energy Initiative, because some of you might not know who we are. We are based on three pillars, research, education, and outreach towards the transformation of the energy sector to more energy but lower carbon. And we do that by having mostly bringing in money from member companies and then handing that money through to research efforts. Our very new research effort is starting 8 low carbon energy research centers in areas of technology that are very important technological areas that are needed to transform our energy sector. I would also like to make some announcement for students. We have in our education office, we have an energy studies minor. And on February 16th, we have an open house. And I'm hoping that if any undergrads are here, you will all come to that event and hear all about the energy studies minor. You can find the details about the event on our website. And I would like to ask faculty members who want to participate in the next round of IHS seminars to get in touch with me so we can start organizing them and invite the speakers that you would like to see here. Now I'm handing it over to Malin Soljacek, and he can introduce our speaker.
So thank you very much, Antje. So it's a pleasure and honor to introduce Professor Eli Yablonovitch from Berkeley. So I first ran into Eli's name when I started research in photonic crystals, which he was an inventor of photonic crystals. So 1/3 of my papers are about photonic crystals, so I have to thank him for that. But Eli is also one of world's foremost thinkers about solar cell technology. So that's, I believe, what he will mostly talk about. For example, there is this widely used limit in solar cell technology called the Yablonovitch limit, which I think you might have something to do with, right? And Eli also is a founder of a company, Alta Devices, which holds the world record in terms of efficiency for solar cells. And Eli understands very well, not obviously just physics of solar cells, but rather has a very deep understanding of the economics of this market. So I thought it'd be particularly interesting to invite somebody who has a deep understanding of both the technology, but also of the economics at the same time. So for his work, Eli got numerous awards. For example, he's a member of National Academy of Engineering, National Academy of Science. He got a Buckley Prize of American Physical Society and many other awards. So let's give a welcome to Eli.
Thank you very much for coming. And I enjoy giving this talk. You'll see it goes beyond the physics. It has physics in it, but it also goes beyond that to trying to figure out how society interacts with science and how new technologies come about and so forth. So it's sort of like a two-part title, as you have noticed. And the second part has to do with the economic and social factors that come into it. So let me start out with the record-breaking solar cell that we just heard about. In fact, I have it right here. It is a single crystal film of gallium arsenide. And for many years, people thought such a thing was impossible. I know people who have spent their entire career working on gallium arsenide, and I do this, and they say, I've never seen that, because it's single crystal, but it's completely flexible. It has many other advantages, but as you can see, over a very brief period of time, around 2011, the efficiency jumped up by a huge amount. And that is regarded as a very huge shift because you see for almost 20 years, the efficiency was unchanged. So something new happened during that time, and I'll try to indicate what that is. The efficiency record was entirely due to the voltage. The current was unchanged, but the voltage jumped up by about 100 millivolts. So that is totally gigantic. And to give an idea how big that is, we had one of the engineers from the company, and this is the company, by the way, Alta Devices. It's the company I founded in the photovoltaic field. And we had the young engineer who made the accomplishment. He broke the world record. And he gave a presentation at the photovoltaic conference. And people, and then he did a very short presentation, 50 minutes, question period. And he said, okay, first question, was this really gallium arsenide? He says yes, because no one could believe that voltage. Okay. Second question, was the gallium arsenide so thin that it was a quantum well, and quantum wells have slightly bigger band gaps? And he says, no, it's a micron thick. There's no quantum confinement effect. So it was rather stunning. So there is some new physics in getting this very high performance. Now, of course, there are probably some people here in this audience who say, well, yeah, you can do great things with gallium arsenide, but it's known that that's an expensive material. It is particularly expensive. It is used where cost any cost is acceptable, for example, for space solar panels. But a lot of that cost in the space solar panels has nothing to do with the photovoltaic cells. It's just all the documentation. They need to prove to NASA that it's been thoroughly tested, and many people have to sign off. And by the time everybody has signed off, the cost is very high. But it can be very, very cheap. And I'll give you an idea of what makes it cheap. And that is that all electronic devices are found on semiconductor substrates. But if you ask, well, what is the active part of the semiconductor substrate, it's the top 1 micron or so. That's the active part. That actually does all the work. Okay, but it sits on maybe half a millimeter of wafer. So maybe you've seen wafers. Can I get a show of who's seen a semiconductor wafer before? So good number of you, and they're just thick pieces of semiconductor. And in the case of gallium arsenide, well, it's not that expensive, but it's not that cheap. And so the thick wafer ends up costing a lot. Now, if you could just get the part that you need, which is the top 1 micron, separated from the substrate, then it won't cost much because you're using so little material. So, for example, this is about 2 microns, but we could make a really good solar cell with a tenth of a micron of material. Okay, and at a tenth of a micron, we could make it out of gold, and it would be okay. So, I know that there has been research Earth abundant materials for solar cells, and I say that's misguided. I hope I don't offend anyone who's working on Earth-abundant materials, but it seems like we can use so little material that we could afford to use expensive materials. But gallium arsenide is not even expensive. I mean, it's just not that expensive. But let me show you what the trick is, because the trick is to separate the working film from the photovoltaic cell. And to do that, we take advantage of one of the great accidents of nature, which is that aluminum arsenide has the same lattice spacing as gallium arsenide. And that means when you grow these things together, the atoms line up and you have a perfect crystal, even though it's two different materials. And so from this, you get a sandwich. This sandwich is called a double heterostructure and was invented in 1963, and they waited until 2000 to give the Nobel Prize in physics for that. So it's kind of a major thing. And we use it in lasers. It enables optical communication, but we also use it in good solar cells. But great that we can make this sandwich, but we can put another layer in the sandwich, this aluminum arsenide. We can make it a very, very thin layer, just a few nanometers thick, and grow this. In fact, that's what this was. This was grown on a 6-inch diameter wafer and underneath it was a few nanometers of aluminum arsenide. And then what happens, and this is one of the, again, the strange things in nature, some things are soluble in acid and some things are not. The aluminum arsenide, even though these are very similar materials, the aluminum arsenide is easily soluble in acid, and the gallium arsenide is not. And the selectivity is about 100 million to one. And so the recognition occurred actually a long time ago that you could come in with the acid, undercut this film, and simply float it off. Okay, and this actually works. At the, this is now on the industrial scale, and it is it's in Alta devices, and they're producing a large amount of material. So it's in production. They have 200 employees, so it's kind of a big deal. And it was already anticipated about 20 years ago. Some nice work out of Netherlands that started getting the big sizes. I can tell you, when I got into this, it took me a week to lift off a square centimeter of material because the acid was so slow. Today they can do this whole thing; they can do this in 2 hours. So it's very economically viable. So the idea that you can have a perfect single crystal, it can perform very highly. It'll break all the world records and so forth. And this is sort of an example. And I've been holding this. And there's nothing to it. I can flex it all day long, and it'll still break the world record. This one is 28.8% efficient. Okay, so this is essentially in production for the past couple of years. Now, this is at a board meeting of the company. This is myself. This is my co-founder, Harry Atwater. And the way it works, and I will describe what happened, is the economic situation became that we had to sell this company, okay? And we had to sell it to this guy, Li Hejun. He's a very controversial Chinese billionaire. So he bought the company, and he increased the employment in the company and so forth. So that's kind of interesting. So you wonder, why did he do that and so on, and what happened there? So that's kind of interesting. Now, let me switch back to the physics before getting to the economics again, and that is, what is different about these kinds of solar cells, that you get an extra tenth of a volt at the operating point? By the way, a tenth of a volt is an awful lot for a solar cell. For example, a silicon solar cell at the operating point is half a volt. So if you add another tenth of a volt, it's like a 20% improvement in performance. So it's very substantial. So let me show you the old picture and the new picture of photovoltaic cells. In the old picture, the sunlight would come in and would produce an electron and a hole, and you'd collect it. And that gave you the record that lasted for 20 years. The new picture is quite different. The new picture says your sunlight comes in, it produces an electron hole, which then find each other, recombine, and produce an infrared luminescent photon that bounces around, is reabsorbed, recombined, re-emitted, and that bounces around, reabsorbed, re-emitted, and finally produces an electron-hole pair that don't recombine, that actually get collected. That's one of the things that can happen. But you see, it's much more complicated, because in some cases, it's actually a good thing for some of that infrared light to escape. And this is very counterintuitive, that it's actually good for some of the infrared light to escape. So the bottom line on what happens in these solar cells is you put them out in the sun, and you might have one sun coming in, but internally, inside this film, there are 30, 40, or 50 suns of luminescent light bouncing around internally. And only if you have that situation will you achieve these very high efficiencies. It's pretty much a requirement. And now, to make this happen, to have the light bouncing around, the material has to be very efficient. I said you create an electron-hole pair, and then you have to create another one after that. So you have to be very efficient at converting the electron-hole pairs into light. And in fact, the material is very efficient. You also need a fantastic rear reflector. So, well, actually a lot better than 95% reflectivity, because you're going to be bouncing around. You're going to be hitting the back surface many, many times. Okay, so what's the thing that gives us the voltage? So I fall back on a voltage formula that was implied in Shockley's paper. So Shockley, a very famous guy, inventor of the transistor, he wrote a paper in 1961 explaining what is the ideal voltage to expect from a solar cell. And implied in his paper is this equation, but this equation was actually first written by a graduate student at UCLA who was working on photosynthesis, because he was inspired. He thought the photosynthesis would be just like the same thermodynamics as a solar cell, and he was right. And he wrote the equation for the expected free energy, or voltage. He wrote it in this way. He expressed it in terms of the external emission of luminescent light. And he said that, well, if this is 100% luminescent efficient, I don't have to subtract anything, because natural log of 1 is 0, and I get the ideal voltage. But if I fail to have 100% luminescent efficiency, I will progressively have less and less voltage. So there's a lesson in this, and the lesson is you don't have to actually measure the voltage in the solar cell. You can measure the amount of luminescent light, and that's like a voltmeter. And in fact, that's how they broke the world record. So let me tell a little vignette about that, is that they would make various films like this, but not all of them were going to break the world record. So what they would do is they would simply shine some light on it and see how much came back as luminescence. And if they had one that was very efficient, they said, oh, that's a great one. Let's try to break the world record with that one. And all through every step in processing, they kept checking to make sure that it was still a fantastic luminescence efficiency. And then at the end, you have to send the films away to the National Renewable Energy Lab. You can't check your own efficiency. You're not allowed to. So they check it. But they knew before they sent it, because they checked the luminescence, that that film would break the world record. So they already knew before they sent it to NREL that it would break the world record. And in fact, before electrical measurements, they already knew that. So that's kind of a neat thing. There's another thing that came out of breaking the world record, is that they started getting these very high voltages, and I was very surprised. But then we realized what the physics was. The physics was what I had on this previous slide. So I said, well, it's all about the rear mirror. Improve your rear mirror, and you're going to break your own record. So what they did is they broke the world record, and then they improved. That was with a mirror of 96% reflectivity. And then they went to a mirror of 97% reflectivity, broke their own record. And then they went to a mirror of 98% reflectivity and broke their own record again, and that's the current world record. So you notice I'm not talking about electrons and holes. I'm just talking about photons and optical properties. And it turns out those are the important things in a good solar cell. So this is what happens when you break the world record, is you get it back from NREL, and they credit you with the very high extraordinary efficiency. So what happens then is how to think about this in the photovoltaic field, and that is, if you have a good solar cell, let's say 25% efficiency, please stop worrying about the electrons and holes. They're fine. Okay. If you want to go above 25% efficiency, it's all about photon management. And in fact, you have to manage the photons in order to get them out. And so I say a great solar cell has to be a great LED. And that's sort of a mantra, that you have to do your best to get the light out. It is very counterintuitive, because why you struggle to absorb the photons, why should you give any back? But surprisingly, it works best when you give some back. It's a little bit like society. We should all give back a little, and then society will work much better. But the physics explanation, unfortunately, is much harder than that. Okay, and it's sort of in this paper, but it's still very extremely counterintuitive to a lot of people, that you'd want to have good external fluorescence. But you know, you go back, and let me go back to this. And yes, it was already known in the 1960s, based on Shockley's work, that we needed to have good emission efficiency. Okay, so then the CEO wanted a higher. He said, "Give me any efficiency as long as the first digit starts with a 3." And so they got the 31.5% efficiency on this cell. This has dual band gap. It looks just like this. You can't tell by looking that there are two layers in here. And you get 31.5% efficiency. So that's pretty good. And let me show you the next one is quadruple junction. 38.8% efficiency. And this was not done by us, but was done at the National Renewable Energy Lab by this very brilliant guy, Miles Steiner. Okay, and so there's a lot of physics in these four layers. You have this layer, and that layer. And it turns out the epoxy is actually playing a big role. There's a lot of interesting optical physics to get this to work right. Very counterintuitively, then, to approach the theoretical limiting performance, you have to give back photons. You have to have external luminescence. To get good external luminescence, you need good internal luminescence. It is actually way above 90%. The internal luminescence in gallium arsenide, it's a greatly underestimated material, it's 99.7% at room temperature. And you need the best possible mirror, and I already mentioned the mirror. So that's what's going on with the physics of the solar cells, that we're going to have these. By the way, the whole cost of this can be made, if you project out the costs at scale, this can be made cheaper than silicon solar panels, and obviously with much higher efficiency. But what's happening in the solar economy? So there have been very big upheavals in the past 5 or 6 years. And it's part of the reason why I had to sell Alta devices. First of all, the crystalline silicon solar panels, the kind that you see on your neighbor's rooftop, they have about 90% market share. So they're being produced. But there was a problem occurred in China where they overbuilt. And they have built now up to 70 gigawatts a year of capacity. First of all, these are gigantic numbers. When I got into this field, the world supply or the world production was about 10 megawatts. And now we're looking at 75 gigawatts. But the problem is the demand is far less than the supply. In fact, this year it is hoped, but far from certain, that the demand will be 60 gigawatts. So we have obviously an oversupply. And when there's an oversupply, there's a price war. And when there's a price war, they fight it out. Now, who here has a background in economics? So a few people. So you know that when there's a price war, they go down to the variable cost. They say, forget about fixed costs. We already sank those in. We're going to fight out this price war. We're at war. So we're going to fight it out until we get down to our variable costs. But what happens is psychology takes over. And they fight even beyond it. So they're losing money even at the variable cost level. They're losing money on these panels. And so this is a very serious matter. Now, I want to indicate how this happened. So the reason why this happened is that in China, they have too many farmers, and they need jobs. And so they want to develop industry. So every province in China wants to develop industry. So I said, oh, we can become the world leader in manufacturing solar panels, and we'll have more jobs for the people who live in this province. The trouble is, every province thought they would be the world capital of solar cell manufacturing. And every province had a big factory to do this. Now, but there is some central control in Beijing. And they noticed that every province was doing this. They said, whoa, wait a minute. This is double the world demand. Just China alone has enough capacity to exceed the world demand. And so what happened is they put out an edict, which they can do. In a communist country, you can give out an edict. And it says, look, unless your plant is a gigawatt a year of capacity, it's below world scale. And I'm sorry, it's too small. And we're going to have to shut you down. Now, how does the province respond? They said, oh my God, let's expand our plant immediately so we get to a gigawatt a year of capacity. Okay? So they did that, and they ended up with this tremendous oversupply situation, which 5 years later is still with us and is only getting worse and worse, at least in terms of the price dropping. So this is very serious. And that price drop is not due to technology. It is due to psychology, economics, politics, not the good reasons. We want good reasons as technological improvement. So let's talk about the technological improvement. And I like this graph. This is called learning curve. They teach this in business school, and basically, like at the Sloan School here. And basically what it says, if you produce more of something, you get smarter and smarter at producing it. So you can produce it at lower cost. So roughly speaking, every time your cumulative production goes up by a factor 2, it is found that you've become 25 or 21, in this case, 21% more efficient at producing that product. And this is very typical. Many products are around 20%. And the solar panels are a little bit better. They're around 21.5%. And that's called the learning curve. You just learned and you got smarter and smarter. Now, I entered the field around this point, 1980, and the price of a panel was $30 a watt. Okay, and this is, by the way, in current dollars. So at that time it was $10, but it's been some inflation since 1980. So what happened then, of course, the learning curve. Now, the learning curve consisted of discrete technological insights and improvements and made the process better. How you make a solar panel, it got better and better, got smarter and smarter about it, and partly due to scale, but also a lot of it is really being smarter about it. And we followed the learning curve for quite a bit, 1980, and went on. There's some disturbances. And then we had a big disturbance in about 10 years ago. And it went above the learning curve. And what happened when it went above the learning curve was that Germany, and this is also has to do with politics. So in Germany, they often have a coalition government. And in Germany, they have the Green Party. And the Green Party said, OK, I will support the coalition government if you have a new policy to subsidize the installation of solar panels. And so they had a scheme where if somebody would install solar panels, the utility would be obligated to buy the electricity at a ridiculously high price. Okay, and then, but who in the end, who paid for it was all the other people who were buying electricity, like the consumers. Their bills went up. Of course, now they're mad about it. But the nice thing is that it didn't show up on the bill until after the solar panels were installed. By then, it was too late. And so these people have 25-year contracts to sell the electricity to the German utility at like 79 euro cents per kilowatt hour. That's kind of ridiculous. That's like maybe 10 times what it should be. It was a ridiculously high price that they locked in for 25 years. As a result, there was a tremendous demand for crystalline silicon because Germany is going to pay any price. Okay, so the price went above. There was a silicon shortage because everybody was building panels and Germany was the big consumer. And so the price went above the learning curve. But then you go flash forward to 2010, 2012, and now the price is below the learning curve. And this is the price war. This is too many factories were built in China, and there's a price war taking place. And this is sort of describing what happened. Silicon shortage 10 years ago, overcapacity starting about 5 years ago. So it's quite, as you can see, it's a substantial perturbation of the learning curve law. Okay, but let's see where we are today. So where we are today is we're looking at maybe the demand is 60 gigawatts per year for last year. The data should be out, but the price keeps dropping. And then I come to the January price for a decent panel is about 43 cents a watt. And by the way, this drop occurred like over a 10-month period. We did not make that much improvement in technology in 10 months. What I think we're seeing is the climax of a price war, that there are companies in China that are trying to drive the price so low that other companies in China will throw in the towel and give up. Of course, since they're all government supported, none of them are going to give up. So I don't see how this ends. Okay, but something major has been accomplished. If you're producing 50 gigawatts a year, it adds up to a very big, substantial impact on humanity. So currently, the cumulative install is very substantial. Who would have expected that? I would never. 300 gigawatts. We're talking very large numbers here. 300 gigawatts have already been installed. But there are some issues. And let me try to indicate the issue. The issue is illustrated by this slide. This was when Germany went crazy. They spent 100 billion euros. They didn't get the cheap panels. In those days, it was very expensive because there was a silicon shortage, among other reasons. And China had not instituted the subsidies yet. So at very great expense, 100 billion euros, Germany installed 40 gigawatts of solar panels, which is like maxed out. They have electricity. They have to give the electricity. They have to pay the neighboring countries to take the electricity at certain times. But you see, here's the problem. And I've chosen a day. By the way, this is all online. You can get the current production and consumption of electricity in Germany. It's available every day. But I chose this day because it was a very special day. It was at the end of May in 2012. And you notice that I've also chosen a Saturday and not a Friday. And the reason is I wanted to show what big impact the solar panels have on Germany. So they had reached a point at high noon on that day, at the end of May, they were actually getting 50% of German electricity was coming from renewables. So it's a fantastic achievement. It was very expensive, but a fantastic achievement. But I'm about to show you what the problem is. So I say, oh, yes, but at morning there's no sunlight, and in the evening there's no sunlight. So it's sort of like a triangle during the daytime. Okay. And that's your solar triangle on the best day of the year. Now, why is May? Notice it's May. So why is May a better day than June? Because there's more sunlight in June than in May. You have to think of the solar panel as like a little thermodynamic engine. And like all thermodynamic engines, it actually works better when it's cooler. And so the result of that is that you're actually going to produce more electricity in May than in June. Okay, and toward the end of May, that's sort of the ideal time. So we picked the ideal day. But even on the ideal day, look what's going on. All the rest of electricity, this is the electricity that you don't turn off at night. Okay, and it just goes on. This is called base load. That's the electricity that you need 24 hours a day. Now, what is the size of that triangle compared to that rectangle? Well, because the base of the triangle is half a day, okay, and so this triangle ends up being one quarter the area of the rectangle. And that means that on the very best day of the year, after spending 100 billion euros, Germany was getting only 20% of its electricity from the solar panels. And then there's a further problem. That was May. Okay. What about November? So November, of course, there's very little sunlight. And so we have to average over the year, especially in Germany. It's pretty far north, so there's very little sunlight. And if you average over the year, Germany is kind of maxed out at 7% averaged over the year. After spending 100 billion euros, only gets 7% of its electricity. And what is the lesson of this? Well, don't overbuild. But I say it's already done. And it's also baked in for the whole world. I'll mention why the world is going to have this problem very shortly. The lesson is we don't just need storage, like batteries and things. We need seasonal storage. And seasonal storage, you have to store for 6 months or longer, it has to be a fuel. Because that's the only thing that we can economically store for such long periods of time. And so it says, look at fuels. And we can't get away from that. Okay. Now, why is the whole world going to suffer from this? So let me do a projection. China, it's not going to shut down the factories. The farmers in China need industrial jobs. They have too many farmers. And they're going to keep producing. Okay. Now, if they produce at this level, they're producing now at this level, but I don't think they're going to build any more factories, but they've got a problem. So the world price, some people say the world price is even less than 40%, but those are probably for very bad panels. But if you ask what is the cost of their production, well, it's very hard to figure out their cost of production because nobody's telling. But if you put in all the capital investment, which they're not getting paid back, that's the money they've lost. By the way, they're very irate about this. It's not like they're proud of it. Their cost of production is probably 60 or 70 cents a watt if they have to pay for the capital. So they're losing money on it, but it doesn't matter. These plants are going to keep going because the jobs are needed. So if you let, if you build 75 gigawatts a year, year after year after year, within, let's say 20 years, I say 30, but maybe within 20 years, the world as a whole will have installed 2 terawatts of solar panels. This is baked in. This is not going away. Okay, and what effect is this going to have on the world energy situation? Well, probably not very much, because on electricity, it had only a 7% effect, and there's a lot of other energy other than electricity. So it's sadly, after the expenditure of lots of money, it's really not going to make that big a difference, but it's we can be proud. It's a big industry. It's fantastic. But it creates somewhat of a problem, because let's say you're doing research in photovoltaics here. You're wedged in between two things. You're wedged in between the subsidies of the low-performing Chinese panels, and you're wedged in with this technology is that the high performance, which will come down in cost, but we cannot afford to expand the production capacity. I don't say we, because it's this guy, Li Hejun. He has to pay for it. He's the owner. He's not going to build additional capacity because there is overcapacity. So if you're doing research on this, this is very troublesome, because on the one hand, there's a huge existing production of the low performing cells. On the other hand, if we ever get rid of all those cheap factories because we don't like them, then something really efficient and low cost will come in. And so it does not leave a lot of room for, yeah, what are you going to do research on then? So this is to justify additional production capacity, also to justify additional research. I say new and different applications are needed. We have to start thinking out of the box, because the solar application, the putting things on roofs, the Chinese already own that, okay? And the factories already built. You don't have to do any research at all, because the factories are already built, and you don't have to build new factories. So where's your research going to go? So I say we need new and different application markets. So I have here some of the things we should think about. I'm telling people, think past the 2 terawatts. The 2 terawatts are baked in. Think past the 2 terawatts and what can be done. And the impact with the 2 terawatts is going to be minimal, maybe 10% impact only on electricity. So what can we do to overcome that? So I said one of the things we need is summer-winter storage. So there is a form of storage that I think could have a big impact on the world. And that is reverse osmosis, which is used in many places now to purify water. And even in California, they have San Diego has reverse osmosis plants. And one of the problems with these plants is you have to supply water with pressure. So you have to have some water pressure. So but the water that you use is very common. It's going to be used for irrigation. So I envision this will be used for irrigation. It's always stored over many years. Now, you may have heard that California had a drought, but we could have a drought for years and years because there's so much water stored. So water is stored in reservoirs, which usually have some significant elevation, and it's stored for years and years. So that's perfect for providing the power to provide the pressure to do reverse osmosis and to provide purified water. So this is happening in many places. For example, Israel gets at least half its water from reverse osmosis. And it is implicit storage, because if you pump water uphill, there's implicit storage, and you're already pumping it uphill because we store the water for dry years, so it covers the seasons. Now they're using ordinary electricity, but as the solar panels get cheaper, so we actually need to make these cheaper and more efficient. I said the current price might be around 45 cents a watt, but they're losing money at 45 cents a watt. In order to do things like this, we have to be super competitive. So now we're looking at 15 cents a watt. So we need new technologies that are way more efficient and way lower cost. Now, let's say we get that. How important is application number one? So application number one is of gigantic importance, because if you have fresh water, what happens to the world's deserts? You can irrigate the world's deserts, okay? And so Saudi Arabia, instead of being the capital of the petroleum industry, it could become a big agricultural area if you had the availability of water desalination. So I say it could potentially have a very big effect on the geography of the world, to the point where even the Sahara Desert becomes a big agricultural area. So let's talk about another application for the future, solar fuels. These are good because we can store them from summer to winter, but they're good for many other reasons. For example, we can use them to pull carbon dioxide out of the air, do all sorts of interesting electrolysis, and maybe make, certainly we can make hydrogen gas, but many other products can be made this way. And so this is an artist's conception of such a factory, but I see this as a very important research area right now, because everybody wants to improve electrolysis. They want to do new, for example, I'm sure there's some people here at MIT want to have better catalysts. And I'm in favor of better catalysts, but in reality, this is almost baked in. The voltage you need to split water is 1.2 volts. We are currently working at 1.7 volts, so it's inefficient by 0.5 volts. But if we struggle very, very hard, we might be able to lower this to 1.6 volts. Okay, and that would be like a fantastic achievement. Well, that's only a 6% drop in the power requirements. The price of the panels drops 6% every few months. So it says we probably have good enough catalysts now. I keep working on the catalysts, but they're probably good enough now. And there are other applications that are new and interesting, and these are a little bit more physics-y. So I'm going to get into these if you'll allow me. But I'm going to pause right now. Does anyone have any questions about this is the sociological, socioeconomic part of the talk, which is now complete. And I would be very happy if people would ask me questions, maybe dispute the picture I painted, or maybe it's too pessimistic. Does anyone have any comments on that? Go ahead.
Okay. United Nations put in a regulation to restrict the Chinese productions of solar panels.
Can we rate? Well, they won't stop. They won't stop. They need jobs. The question was, can you stop the overproduction from China by regulation, maybe by international treaty? No, it's not going to happen. They need jobs. The factories are built. It's too late. The money's been spent, and they're going to continue. Another question. Go ahead.
Basically, Desert Bloom by RO was a big kick on the OSW about 1970. Currently, it takes about 2 kilowatt hours to produce a cubic meter of water, and as with solar, the energy cost is no longer dominant, capital costs are dominant.
Right.
That means you've got to run 24/7. You can't do that in solar
issues. Yeah, okay. So let me state the question for the microphone. So the point was that, yes, we can reduce the cost of electricity, but because of capital costs, we have to run the reverse osmosis plants all day long to recover the capital cost. But keep in mind, this was a storage concept. So we pump the water uphill during the daytime, and this gives us the potential energy to drive reverse osmosis. So we do indeed plan to drive the reverse osmosis 24 hours a day, just like what you're saying. Okay, let me go on. It's going to get a little more physics-y, because we talked about two major applications. They may not have, I don't think they have a lot of obstacles, but we do have to keep making the solar panels better and better, and lowering cost is not contradictory with higher efficiency. In fact, this particular technology is both low cost and also, I believe it's the lowest cost and also the highest efficiency. Yeah.
But you said that the top one could open up if, for example, the price dropped. We figured out new technology that the price would drop to 10 or 15 cents.
Yes.
But like the same thing is like right now, you said Chinese are basically covering their variable costs, right? So, and that puts them at about 40 or 50 and something like that, right? So if you actually did come up with a new concept that you put 10 or 15 cents, then your argument
that Chinese would nevertheless keep doing it, it's not so obvious, right?
Because well, that's right. I think you're pointing out is that we do need new technology. But the other thing I'm pointing out in reply to that, the gallium arsenide is the new technology. The gallium arsenide has the potential to get down to about 10 cents a peak watt. The problem is that to get there, we have to go down our own learning curve. We have to invest in plants. If someone is willing to spend billions of dollars right now to leapfrog the Chinese plants, I believe that this could be done. But I have not been able to persuade anyone to do this kind of investment during a price war. Okay, and so what I'm suggesting is we should look at other things instead of doing direct competition. And so I have here a couple of other things, and I'm going to jump to this sort of second application, and this thing, electroluminescent refrigeration, because it's kind of interesting. So it's related to this, to what new technology is opened up when we have a good reflector on the back of the solar cell. In fact, it needs to be a very good LED. And so one of the new applications that has opened up is something called electroluminescent cooling. And it's sort of interesting. It's a little bit different. Let me show you what it is. We have traditionally these things called thermoelectric coolers. And you run electric current, and it makes something cold and makes something else hot. Let me give you an idea how that works. You run electric current, and you force it over a potential barrier. And to get over the potential barrier, it has to pick up some heat, some energy. So it picks up some energy, and it cools this metal. And then the current goes down, and it gives back the energy on the other side. And so the one side, the first metal gets cold, and the second metal gets hot. And this is thermoelectricity. Now, one way of saying is the electric current drags heat from left to right. But the fancy way of saying this is that the electric current drags entropy from left to right. So entropy is one way of expressing heat. And this is roughly how it works. You drag the entropy from one side to the other, and so forth. Now, I want you to think about a solar cell. So I showed you the record solar cell. There's light coming in from all directions. So there's a lot of randomness. The light is very disordered. It's sunlight. It's we want to get all the light from all the sky. It comes from all directions, and because there's so much disorder in the sunlight, we can't get the full photon energy. So you say, how much energy can we get from those photons? Well, we get the photon energy, but we have to subtract off some energy due to this disorder or the entropy of the sunlight. So sometimes people are very surprised. I say, you go out in the parking lot, and the sunlight that you see has entropy. And they said, whoa, I never heard about that. But it should be taught. It's not that hard to calculate the entropy of sunlight. But so there's a certain amount of entropy. And you, of course, you won't get the full photon energy. And so this is the entropy term. It's a rather famous term. If you've taken thermodynamics, this would be the same as saying U minus TS, which is called free energy, which is the same as electricity. So you're not going to get out the photon energy. So the photon energy is 1.4 volts, and the record solar cell gets roughly 1.1 volts. So well, we live with that. You know, we kind of accept it. It's good. It still broke the world record. But the problem is photons are not pure energy. Some photons are, but the sunlight is not pure energy. And pure energy would be if you had a laser. That would be highly directed. It would be very different from sunlight. Or the wall outlet. The wall outlet produces a sine wave, and that is pure energy. There's no entropy associated with it. So we lick our wounds and we pay the price. We pay 0.3 volts for this because we went from 1.4 to 1.1. Okay, now I'm going to flip the arrow of time. I'm going to reverse everything. Now the photons are coming out instead of going in. And I said that the LED was the inverse of the solar panel. The solar panel takes in light and produces electricity. The LED takes in electricity and produces light. So I'm just running it in reverse. And the other thing I said, a great solar cell should also be a great LED. So I'm just turning it into an LED. I'm running it backwards. And what is my input? Well, it's the same as the previous output. So the input is 1.1 volts, but the output are these big 1.4 volt photons. So where does the extra 3/10 of a volt come from? Okay. And where it comes from, obviously, it's pulling heat out of the lattice. And it is producing not a laser beam, but very disordered light. Obviously, your LED light bulb, it's sending light in all directions. And so there's a lot of entropy associated with that. So the light from an LED bulb is carrying away entropy. And it is cool, and the LED itself should be getting cold. Okay? So I like to ask this question: how many people have installed the new LED light bulbs? Okay, so quite a few of you. And if you touch them, you notice that they're not cold. I just said they should be cold, but they're not cold. But they are actually cooler than you should expect based on the efficiency of the light bulb. And so you need to have a high efficiency, and then they will actually get cold. Because it's maybe actually at above 80% efficiency, they would start getting cold. And so you would touch the light bulb, and it actually would be cool to the touch. But it is still cooler than you would expect, because this refrigeration mechanism is occurring in every one of your light bulbs. So this is kind of interesting. And so I hope everybody's OK with this, because there's a lot of disorder. It had to come from somewhere, so it came from the LED and made the LED cold. OK, so what's going on here is that when the LED emits light, it drags entropy with it and makes the LED colder. And there's a lot of entropy in the LED light. Okay, and roughly speaking, it's according to the voltage. So if you need only 1.1 volts, but you're getting 1.4 volt photons, that's the amount of cooling power. That's a lot of cooling power. That's 3/10 of a volt per photon. So that's regarded as a lot of cooling power. And that tells us that at 80% efficiency, we're going to get net cooling. But we've been struggling to make the solar cell into an LED. So naturally, we think we can improve the efficiency of the LED. So I've been around a lot, and I've had the privilege of working in a number of different places. And I've met a lot of people. And one of the people I met, is I remember him very, very well. His name was Al Rose. He was a veteran of the RCA labs. In fact, he is the inventor of the Vidicon camera. And so he's a very distinguished physicist. And that camera was the television camera between 1940 and 1980 until the CCD cameras came in. So he's a very accomplished guy. And he would tell me stories. I had lunch with him every other day. And he would always tell me stories, what it was like in the old days. And he told me about the American Physical Society March meeting. Now today, if you go to American Physical Society March meeting, which is a month from now, there are going to be 10,000 physicists. It's kind of amazing. He said, well, in those days, there were about two dozen. And he says, I would go, and Shockley would go, and there were a few others. Okay, and so it was a small group. And they all knew each other. And he said, Shockley was teasing me. Okay, and he teased him with the following riddle. So I'm going to show you the riddle. The riddle is that you have an LED that produces light that goes into a photovoltaic cell, which produces electricity, and the electricity gets sent around and drives the LED. Okay? So Shockley asks, Shockley, of course, was the smartest guy in the room. In case you were wondering, you could always ask Shockley. Okay? And so Shockley's teasing Al Rose and, explain to me how this is impossible. Why is it impossible to make a perpetual motion machine? Now, I think Shockley was like a very good lawyer. He knew that you never ask a question unless you already know the answer. I think Shockley already knew the answer, but he was teasing Al Rose. Okay. And so the question was, is this a perpetual motion machine? And the answer is, well, there's a lot of inefficiency and friction. Nothing's perfect. So, well, it's not exactly a perpetual motion machine, but if you put a battery in here, you can make up for the friction, and then it's a pretty good heat engine or refrigerator. So what happens is you put in the electricity here, the LED gets cold, the photons transfer over here, the photovoltaic cell gets hot, but you lose a little bit of voltage, and so you put a battery in here. And so this becomes a way of driving a refrigerator, or in reverse, it would be driving a heat engine. So I would say Shockley probably knew that LEDs became cold. But in case he didn't realize it, it was 2 years later it got published. So it got published by this condensed matter physicist, Jan Tauck, down here. He was a very distinguished solid-state theorist at Brown University. He was like the guy at Brown. And but when he was a young person in Czechoslovakia, he wrote a paper, refrigeration, or thermal energy taken from surroundings in a p-n junction. So he already knew, was already published, that an LED can be a refrigerator. But what changed? Well, what changed is that we now make fantastic solar cells, which are fantastic LEDs. We have great mirrors on the back to get the light out. The material itself is of fantastic quality and is very efficient internally. So now we can countenance these ideas. We can make a refrigerator this way. And the way to think about it is that you're dragging heat from the LED and you drag it over to the photovoltaic cell. And it's just like the original picture of the thermoelectric generator. But now it's working with photons, where previously the current was the active medium. In this case, the active medium is photons. Now, here's how such a refrigerator would work. You have one of these films is a LED, and one of them is a photovoltaic cell. And they face each other, okay? And you put a little extra voltage in, and one of them gets cold, and the other one gets hot, okay? And there's sort of a lucky coincidence. When gallium arsenide gets cold, the band gap gets a little bit bigger, making it a little bit easier to absorb the sunlight in the photovoltaic cell. It's a little nuance there. What makes this possible? Of course, we said already, the excellent reflector on the back and the excellent material. And so we asked, well, what about the material? How good can the material be? So with gallium arsenide, you can get 99.7% internal luminescent efficiency. I once had a referee who agreed to let me put that in the title of a scientific article. So 99.7% internal efficiency at room temperature. It gets better at low temperature. And there's another material that's used for laser cooling. So laser cooling is very similar to what I just showed you, except it's not as good. In laser cooling, you get like a tiny amount of cooling per photon, and here you get 3/10 of a volt of cooling per photon. So, but it's used. There's a whole field of laser cooling. It's quite amazing. But I'm trying to convince them all to go to electroluminescent cooling, but that's a whole new set of skills. As soon as you have to put wires onto your semiconductor, it's a whole different world. So we'll see how they adapt. But I believe there will be now, if there's laser cooling, there will be a field of electroluminescent cooling. Now, there are issues. There are the mirror. I'm not going to dwell on the mirror. We can make very good mirrors. And or you skip the mirror, have the light emission from both sides. That's very ideal. The photons go out, and you can get a very high performance. So let me show you the performance. So I put here the performance of a thermoelectric cooler. And you get about 1/10 of Carnot. So Carnot is the theoretical limit. Unfortunately, with the thermoelectrics we have today, we get about 1/10 of the Carnot efficiency. However, with these electroluminescent coolers, depending upon the reflectivity, depending upon material quality, it just goes up and up. And I believe we can easily get to 3/10 of the Carnot limit, but I think we'll be able to get to 5/10 of the Carnot limit. So it's quite good. Now, how would you use this? So I need to explain how you would use it by showing an example. Suppose you had a challenge. I want to give you a challenge. You want to have a very simple refrigerator to preserve vaccines in Africa where they can't rely upon the electricity for the refrigeration. Okay, so you have to have another way of getting. So we're going to store the vaccines inside a thermos bottle. And the really good thermos bottles, they have vacuum, and they coat the surfaces with a reflective metal. So it's silver coated. Okay. That's a normal thermos bottle. Now we have one of the new refrigerators. So instead of coating it with an ordinary metal, we coat parts of it with an ordinary metal, but the cold part we coat with one of these films. We wrap one of these films around the center of the thermos bottle, okay, and we drive it as an LED. So this is the LED. We drive it, and then it sends photons over to the photovoltaic cell, and that gets hot. And so we have essentially a refrigerator. We have the vacuum insulation. We already had the vacuum insulation in the conventional thermos model. We need not to waste light, so we have reflectivity, but we already had reflectivity in the conventional thermos model. And of course, the cells themselves have a very good reflectivity. So this is kind of a neat application. You put a little bit of thermal storage in it, but you do need a little electricity. So on the outside, you put a small solar panel, and it provides the electricity. So when it's sitting out in the sun, the refrigerator is working better and better. And then at night, it's a thermos model, so it's going to store the cold temperatures at night. So it's pretty good. The more you leave it in the sun, the colder it gets. So that's sort of a neat application. So I've given you a number of applications here, and I didn't get into the car. You can drive a car with something called thermophotovoltaics. It's actually been done, but we need to improve the efficiency. But there are other things. There's this electroluminescent refrigerator, and there are many markets. So for example, if you can get into cars, the car market is actually 10 times bigger than the market of solar panels for utilities. So I would say the lesson here is that because of the situation in China, we now have to think beyond that. We have to leapfrog what is the next big technology. And there are some very big technologies that have to be developed, but the existing technology in China will not be able to keep up. So we have to leapfrog. And so I hope I've been able to share some excitement with you. Thank you. Go ahead.
What would that 7% for Germany be in the Sahara or in the middle of Texas?
Okay, that's a very good question. The question was, in Germany, you have the seasonal variations, which make it very difficult. And I'm going to rephrase the question. What if you were in Singapore and every day was a 12-hour day? Okay. And so the seasonal storage would not be as much of a problem. So that says in Singapore, if they don't have much land area for solar panels anyway, but if you're going to do solar panels in Singapore, you can keep up with regular batteries. So that goes along the path that many people are going now, is make the batteries cheaper. That would be suitable for a country like Singapore. But you have to look at the worldwide market. Most of the world is seasonal. And so you're not going to get that deep penetration you want unless you have seasonal storage.
Yes.
You said that we need to have seasonal storage, and that one of the applications is in solar fuel. There's a strengthening of interest in what are called now liquid organic hydrogen carriers, which are basically 5- and 6-ring compounds,
yes,
that can drop and pick up hydrogen,
right,
depending on temperatures. Because of your interest in this leapfrogging market, what do you see in liquid fuel,
okay,
subsystems?
Very, very good question. Yeah, terrific question. Let me rephrase the question for the microphone. We know about batteries. We know about creating hydrogen, but there is another alternative. There are organic molecules that can that have extra hydrogen in them, and then we can just store those liquids with the extra hydrogen. And if the liquids are sufficiently inexpensive, then instead of making hydrogen gas, we would just add the hydrogen to this liquid. And a liquid, obviously, is a little bit easier to store than a gas, although hydrogen can be stored underground, so it's not that hard. So it's a great idea, and I became very excited. I know that Jim Gordon of Harvard told me he was working on it, and I encouraged him very, very strongly. And I'm very eager to hear about further progress along those lines. But in addition to that, you have other new things. For example, using electricity to create, not just to create hydrogen, we kind of think we know how to do that, but to create hydrocarbons. So it's been demonstrated that just with copper, the catalyst is copper, this is not a mysterious catalyst, they are able to get, instead of just hydrogen, they're able to get 30% methane. Okay, there are even some schemes that they hope that they can efficiently produce ethane. Now, if you can produce ethane, ethane is two carbons. If you polymerize ethane, you get gasoline and you get diesel fuel. You can do a huge number of things. Ethane is like very, very valuable stuff. And so the direct production of various forms of hydrocarbons from electricity, I think, is very exciting. So I held a workshop on this at Berkeley a year ago. And at this workshop, I got all the people who are experts, and we talked about it. Of course, it's not quite ready for prime time. So here's what I learned from that workshop, is that even if we're never successful with the solar fuels, or even if we're not successful with the carriers for the hydrogen, the organic molecule carriers for hydrogen, if all we ever produce is hydrogen, the impact could be gigantic, and much higher than what we have with electricity today. So this is another leapfrogging concept. What we noticed, they had done studies at the Lawrence Berkeley lab, how can we use hydrogen? Well, we can use hydrogen in the chemical process industry. For example, to make ammonia, which is fertilizer, and to do other things that we do in oil refineries where we need hydrogen gas. So that's a chemical process industry needs hydrogen. It's a huge market. Okay, second thing that you can do, we have now the fuel cell cars. So the fuel cell cars run on hydrogen. Okay, what if a significant fraction of the car fleet runs on hydrogen? Then that's a huge market that is actually bigger than the electricity market. Then there's one more important market to look forward to, and that is that you blend the hydrogen into the natural gas. So natural gas is a huge industry in the United States and an extremely important industry. Now, we cannot replace natural gas with hydrogen for the following reason. The steel pipes that are used for the natural gas would suffer hydrogen embrittlement. So there's a limit to the partial pressure of hydrogen that you can carry in a steel pipe. And that is actually pretty decisive. But up to that limit, we can put the hydrogen into the natural gas supply. Maybe it represents 5 or 10%. We blend hydrogen 5 or 10% with methane, and it's a huge market. It's a very huge market, and we can safely blend it up to that level. So we have huge markets for hydrogen, even if the other things don't become successful. So I'm hoping the other things become extraordinarily successful. But if not, we're still going to be fine producing hydrogen. The problem is the things that you produce, like hydrogen, they tend to be cheaper than electricity. Electricity tends to be pretty expensive stuff. So that's why we can't stop where the Chinese are. The Chinese are stuck. They're losing money at 50 cents a peak watt. We need to leapfrog them with other technologies that can go down to 15 cents a peak watt. And the cost also has a lot to do. If you make more efficient, the cost goes down due to balance of systems costs and so forth. So I think that has been sort of the moral of the story, has been to try to anticipate, okay, it's too late, the Chinese have that market, but what about after that market? What new technologies could be introduced? And they simply have to be a lot better than what's out there now.
I like the idea of leapfrogging silicon on cost. I mean, with the guy Marston, what is the cost and number of times you can actually reuse the wafer? Because the wafer itself is still very expensive.
Right? Okay, yes, that's a good question. At all to devices, the wafer is not part of the variable cost. It's part of the capital cost because we never give it away. We keep reusing it over and over again. And the answer is as follows. When you peel these films, most of the time, it's perfect, and everything comes off, and everything's fine. But every now and then, you create a little bit of damage on the wafer. Okay, so what you have to do every time you peel the film, and by the way, the peeling is you just come along with a vacuum chuck, and you go with suction, and it pops off like that. Okay, and but sometimes it leaves a little bit of damage on the wafer, and then you have to etch the wafer down a little bit in order to refresh the surface, okay? And if you include that way of doing it, then it's thousands of times. You can reuse the wafer thousands of times. In fact, all to devices, it has been years since it had to buy any new wafers. It has everything has been on reused wafers for the past few years.
Yeah. If one of the devices has brought down the cost of using like thin gallium arsenide devices, is that same technology you transfer to other gallium arsenide devices other than solar? Like HVDs or...
Okay, so the question is, this peeling method, can it be used for other devices? And, well, I was giving, about 2 years ago, I was giving a talk in Berlin, and I was sort of like the invited speaker, and then they've been just before me was an invited speaker from Osram. So Osram is the European company that makes light bulbs, but they don't make light bulbs anymore, they make LED lamps. And I didn't know the gentleman, and he introduced himself to me, and he said, "Oh, it's great meeting you. I really have to thank you. You've had a big impact on my career." And I said, "What are you talking about?" And he says, "Well, you wrote a paper on peeling the LEDs, and you had a certain design of LEDs, and we were competing with HP Optoelectronics. We needed our own design. So basically, the bottom line is that." He told me that they have been in production with this peeling method. They've been in production for the past 15 years and producing very large amounts and also extending it eventually to gallium nitride using a different peeling method with a laser liftoff for the gallium nitride. So he told me a few things, and he asked me about it, but they had been keeping it confidential. And so at a certain point in time, he clammed up. And he wouldn't tell me anything anymore, but apparently it's been in production. It's just if you do large areas, that is a new discovery. To do areas of this size, so LEDs, you just do a submillimeter piece. I could do submillimeter pieces. That's very, very easy. To do something this size in 2 hours is an amazing accomplishment. I credit the people working at Alta Devices, and I think they've done something very important in technology. And I would go a little further. I've been arguing for a long time that in the semiconductor world, we should not be doing heteroepitaxial growth. We should be doing thin film transfer. And it's been a long, hard argument, but I think it's gradually winning. The argument for transferring films is gradually winning, and there's more and more of the thin film transfer taking place now.
A little bit on the prospects of liftoff for narrow bandgap photovoltaics, you know, for TPVs?
This is gallium arsenide. There's an application I didn't have time for called thermophotovoltaics, where thermal radiation produces electricity directly and by sending the radiation onto a photovoltaic cell. Because we can't make things that hot, we can't make it as hot as the sun, we need a smaller bandgap. So this band gap is 1.4 volts. It's a perfect match to the sun. But if we try to do thermophotovoltaics, we need a band gap around 0.8 of a volt. And that's not gallium arsenide. So there are materials. There's an alloy called indium gallium arsenide that grows very well on indium phosphide. And it can also be peeled off. So you have to adapt the process. I can't point to a company. There's no company doing this. You'd have to figure out how to do this yourself. Most of the researchers just etch away the indium phosphide, and they're left with the thin film. But I regard that as wasteful. So in that case, it has been demonstrated on indium phosphide at a university. Okay, Harry Atwater has demonstrated the peeling of the indium gallium arsenide off of indium phosphide. So the size is maybe a square centimeter or so, not very big.
Do you have an opinion about, you know, there's a large class of 2D materials, monolayer, a few layers, which can be transferred, peeled, growing in the square meters?
Yeah, that's an example. I'm very glad you brought that up. So the question related to the new discovery that emerged in the past 5 years, that there are semiconductors that consist of a monolayer, and they're usually they have sulfur in them, so they're called chalcogenides. It's the name of compounds that have sulfur and selenium in them. Now, these are fantastic semiconductors. So probably everyone here has heard of graphene, but graphene is actually not that interesting. They gave the Nobel Prize for graphene, but it's not that interesting a material because it's a semi-metal. To us, it's far more interesting to have a semiconductor. And these chalcogenide monolayers actually are semiconductors, which is fantastic. They have lots of very exciting properties. It's a great research area. I'm in it. I love those materials. Now, are they useful for photovoltaic cells? Doesn't seem clear right now. They are thin, they're fantastic, they're monolayer thick, but it's not enough to absorb sunlight. So then you'd have to stack up a great many of them. It might get interesting, but it is, I wouldn't say it's a natural application for what we're talking about. But certainly extremely exciting and might be of practical utility.
Idea.
Yeah.
So as you said, it has been first come up like 50 years ago, someone finding out, and then
actually exactly 60 years ago.
60 years ago, yeah. What is, and now as you said, LED internal efficiency has already 99%, and then solar cell you can make, if you have single wavelength, they can be also pretty efficient. What is prohibiting it from, you see that from being realize this kind of system.
Okay, so you're asking what's holding electroluminescent refrigeration back?
Yeah.
I think that nobody took it seriously for 60 years, so you're right about that. But I would say what has emerged is that now we're accustomed, we know this is needed for high efficiency solar cells, and we need to make a good LED. So now people are thinking about how to make a good LED. And you have to go back. And so, for example, my graduate student who's working on this, he gave a talk at laser cooling. And I said, the laser cooling people, they're not really making LEDs. So you have to teach them how to make LEDs. So designing a good LED, it's like a specialty. I mean, there's not a lot of people in the world who are really good LED designers, because you have to worry about parasitics and all the things that can happen. But I expect it to emerge now. Because the temptation is very strong. If there are so many groups working on laser cooling, this is way better than laser cooling. But you actually have to make an electrically pumped device, and you have to actually know how to design it right for it to be that efficient. So the slides I just showed you, we were thinking around room temperature. But it came to our attention a couple of weeks ago, which we knew, but we didn't take it into account, that the gallium arsenide, it's 99.7% efficient internally. But at low temperatures, it's even higher. In fact, we don't even know how high it is. It's certainly above 99.9. So we think that it could be also a very good refrigerator around 100 Kelvin. And we think there are a lot of prospects there. But you can ask, why hasn't this been done, or what's holding us back? What held us back from the high-efficiency record-breaking solar cell? It's not like people weren't interested in breaking records. People are always interested in that. Sometimes it's just obvious things, like, I have to replace the substrate eats photons, so I have to get rid of the substrate and put a good mirror back there. It's not exactly gravity waves, okay? It's just good, solid, sometimes you just have to think of the obvious, and suddenly it has a big impact. Okay, so I don't think there was anything holding us back scientifically except a mental block. Didn't realize it could be done, never thought such efficiencies were realistic, didn't see any application if I could do it, et cetera, et cetera. So I think we're past the psychological barriers now, and so I expect to see more of it. But it's not uncommon in science to have tremendous psychological barriers. I could give a whole nother lecture on the psychological barriers.
At this point, I think we should wrap up, and there is a reception after, so you can ask Eli some more questions.
Yeah.
So let's thank Eli for...